This is the Bookwaves Artswaves Hour. Interviews with writers on KPFA's nationally syndicated Bookwaves program, along with interviews about film and theater and archive book interviews that stretch back four decades. I'm your host, Richard Wolinsky. On today's program, Gail Sheehy, whose profiles graced the pages of the New Yorker magazine for decades, and whose book passages about what happens in each stage of our life, died of pneumonia, most likely related to COVID-19, on August 24th. I interviewed her in 2014 for her memoir, Daring My Passages, and we'll hear that interview today on the Bookwaves portion of the program. And on the Artswaves half hour, an interview with playwright Madhuri Shekar, whose play In Love and Warcraft is being performed live online by members of ACT's MFA program this weekend and next, and then streamed on demand the following week. But first, these announcements. And for more information and tickets, you can go to the various websites. I've linked those websites and others on today's program page at kpfa.org. If you want to be listed, please write to bookwaves@hotmail.com. First, from bookstores. The Booksmith presents Joe William Trotter Jr. and his book Workers on Arrival, Black Labor in the Making of America, on Monday, September 7th at 11 a.m. And on Tuesday, September 8th at 6 p.m., Julian Guthrie with Good Blood, and both are free with RSVP. Books, Inc. presents a book launch with Carol Bumpus and Searching for Family and Traditions at the French Table. That's later today at 5 p.m. And there's a talk about children's literature with author Shirin Yim Bridges and editor Amy Noveski on Wednesday, September 9th at 5 p.m. This weekend's book passage ticketed events are Louise Penny on Saturday, September 5th at noon Pacific time, and Jody Pico on Sunday, September 6th at 4 p.m. Pacific. And over in the world of theater, San Francisco Playhouse presents a discussion between Susie DeMilano and Stacey Ross tonight at 7 p.m., and you can register for live stream access on SF Playhouse's website. The Marsh presents class performances in which David Ford's class members perform 20-minute monologues live streamed next Monday, September 7th and Tuesday, September 8th at 7:30 p.m. TheatreWorks' production of the musical Pride and Prejudice can be streamed with an Amazon Prime subscription. Theatre Rhino presents Fillmore with John Fisher tonight at 8 p.m. on Zoom and on John Fisher's Facebook page. And Other Letters is a queer and diverse take on A.J. Gurney's Love Letters, and that can be seen on Zoom Tuesday, September 8th at 7 p.m. New Conservatory Theatre Company presents In Good Company. It's a podcast about life when it goes off script. And the first three episodes are now available streaming. And now on to Bookwaves. Gail Sheehy, noted journalist and author, died on August 24th, 2020, of complications from pneumonia, possibly brought on by COVID-19. She was 83. I had a chance to interview Gail Sheehy at Book Passage Bookstore in Corte Madera, California, on September 26, 2014, while she was on tour for her final book, a memoir, Daring My Passages. I began by asking her about the correct pronunciation of her last name.
It's Sheehy.
Sheehy.
And I often say it's she and he back to back because I'm an equal gender equality.
As one of the founders of new journalism in the 1960s, and we look at new journalism today and how things have blurred between fact and fiction, when you look at that and you look at the origins of new journalism, do you think things took a wrong path at some point?
Not at all. And it's not about blurring the lines between fact and fiction. The new journalism was about using the tools of fiction to make reading journalistic stories more interesting and deeper, because the practitioners of the new journalism practice saturation reporting. Saturation reporting meant that we plunged ourselves into the milieu of the situation we were reporting about, or in my case, I did character studies of people that I wanted to write character profiles about. I would interview 40 or 50 people around my subject before I ever went to the subject. But by then, I knew almost more about him or her than they knew about themselves, because a lot of it they'd forgotten, or they had a different view of what they actually did in childhood. So I would then collaborate with them and with their avid interest in trying to piece together the habit of action at different stages of their life, because that would be the best way to predict what kind of a leader it would be.
At New York Magazine, you worked under Clay Felker. And, of course, you were married to Clay Felker later on. What kind of advice did he give you in terms of this kind of reportage?
Well, the first thing was he believed in point of view. Objective reporting was kind of a fantasy. The idea that you could put aside all of your, you know, psychosocial training for years and your habits and attitudes when you went to report something. So he said, let's just take it the way it is honestly. Everybody has a point of view. And he would marry the journalist with the story that he thought it would make the most interesting point of view on whatever it was, you know, the Ferguson riots or Vietnam veterans coming home. And then the other thing was to use dialogue, where you could use scene setting. And that was what he did with me the very first assignment he gave me. I pitched him a story when I was just a girl journalist up in the women's department where they had us sequestered. And I dared to pitch him a story. And I told him this story about a scene that I had seen young men, kind of loser men, who had rented a house on Fire Island, and they wanted to attract beautiful women. So they offered them free space in the house. And if they would sit on their beach blanket, attract other beautiful women like flies. Paper. And I said, they were holding specimen viewing parties. That got his interest. He said, did you go to a specimen viewing party? I said, of course. He said, then write it just like you described it. Take us there. Take us to that scene. And that was my jumping off point. He was daring me to do something different, as he did everybody else. And so I wrote a story that took you to that scene. And that's what the new journalism was.
And people like Tom Wolfe practiced it as well. Wolf, I think, later wound up being a right-winger. Is that correct?
Well, I think he always was, but he held his conservatism very close to the vest because he was mainly just a demon satirist. Absolutely had a scalpel with humor all over it. And you couldn't read anything of Tom Wolfe that didn't make you crack up and make you see what you were looking at with a different lens.
Do you think that new journalism that you practiced, I'm just wondering where it's taken us, Gail Sheehy?
Well, I think the simplest part of new journalism, which is setting a scene before you start giving the facts, right, has been incorporated in all journalism. That's what you see front page of the New York Times. They'll always have a couple of paragraphs setting, you know, it's about Tony in this situation and how his life has fallen apart. And then they'll go on to tell you what the social science is behind that. What has happened is the consolidation of media owners, having like six corporate owners constantly, you know, squeezing, so that now there isn't enough room to do saturation reporting. There isn't enough money to send a journalist to somewhere for a month or two, except on rare occasions. Right. Certainly, the New York Times does it, the New Yorker, New York Magazine, The Atlantic, and some others. But by and large, everything has gotten much shorter, much more immediate. It's all Twitterized. It's online. There's no more that, you know, a 750-word story is a long story. Our stories were minimum 5,000 words, often 8,000 or 10,000 words.
Gail Sheehy, how long did it take you to do one of these long-form stories? And in terms of the support for it, were you on salary at New York?
No, I wasn't. I was always a freelance writer because I had a child and I had to be at home doing work. But I also went off on long reportage. I spent a month in London to write about Prime Minister Thatcher for Vanity Fair and interviewed 55 people. and came up with a story that was hilarious in one aspect about her electrical baths, which were making her look 20 years younger when she was in her 60s. And I had to actually take an electrical bath. It's a perfect example of saturation reporting. I actually had to strip naked, climb up on the top stool, and get into this bath that was operated by an Indian Ayurveda specialist who manipulated the current to, you know, release your energy. And I had done a lot of things for a journalistic story, but electrocution wasn't one of them. So this was my first experience. And it actually was quite a pleasant sensation. And it led to opening up the whole relationship between Margaret Thatcher and Mikhail Gorbachev, which was a huge world-changing relationship because Madame Veronique finally let me know that Thatcher had recommended Gorby to be in her tub.
And you met all these people, so I want to ask you a little bit about your view of what it was like to see them and what you thought of them. You went to dinner with Henry Kissinger, and I know that for a lot of us, Henry Kissinger is kind of like the arch devil.
Absolutely,
you know?
And he was in my mind. I didn't go to dinner with him. My husband then, Clay Felker, or he wasn't yet my husband, but we were living together, invited him to dinner, and I was the hostess. And I said, how can you? He's the killer of Cambodia. And we had a Cambodian refugee who was ultimately going to be our child. And then he invited Kay Graham and a lot of other stars, David Frost and so on. And how to put this dinner together was terrifying. But what I saw was that Kissinger and Kay Graham, then head of the Washington Post, would publish the Pentagon Papers and infuriated Nixon. And she was probing Kissinger about, you know, what was Nixon going to do to her? And he was baiting her and kidding her about how bad it was going to be. But what you saw was they were actually like kin. They were great friends. They went to the movies together. They went to private dinners together. They were arch opposites politically, but power loves power. And so they were friends.
And that brings up a question of the Washington elite. I mean, if they're all on some level friends. And, you know, I remember once I talked to Molly Ivins and she said, oh, George W. Bush, yeah, he's a nice guy, but his policies kill people. And then you start thinking, well, wait a second, these elites, do they even understand that?
Well, I agree with you. I think that they need each other. They are always extracting things from each other, and they use each other. And they're in the same elite level. And so it's just like actors love to be with actors, and writers love to be with writers, and powerful politicians love to be with their own kind. So I think it's probably always been that way. And now I wish it were more that way. Because it used to be that political enemies in Congress, you know, went out and schmoozed together, had beers together. Their families got to know each other. And there, that laid the groundwork for compromise, which is the only way you get anything done.
Which doesn't happen anymore.
That's right.
You also wrote a book about Hillary Clinton. And, of course, a lot of talk now is that she's going to be president. Two things. First of all, do you think that a president really has that much power, no matter who it is? I mean, they have some power, but what do they have? And secondly, when you look at somebody like Hillary Clinton, what do you see?
Well, the first question is, the president of the United States has a huge amount of power. Just think about the power that Barack Obama had to pull back on bombing ISIS 3 years ago, and now is being excoriated for it by our European partners, and the power he has now to say we're bombing in Syria. Nobody knew that we were suddenly going to be raining bombs down on Syria. He announces it, and it's done. Who did that? When he was president and Hillary was Secretary of State, and she, you know, deeply believed that we needed to go after ISIS in Syria at that time. She lost, he won, because he's president. Hillary is an enormously complicated character, but what I've observed over the many years of writing about her and watching her and talking to her, how much she's grown. The amazing thing to many people is that Hillary didn't have independence, she felt, until she was 53 years old. She could not speak with her own voice. She had to postpone her own political ambitions. and all the way to the end of, you know, saving Bill Clinton from impeachment. She always had to put herself on the back burner. But at the very moment that the Senate was deciding on his impeachment, she was planning at 53 to run for the Senate and said to me, "For the first time, I'm making my own decisions. It's such a relief." Since then, she lost in 2008. It was a bitter loss for her, although she wouldn't allow herself the bitterness and counseled all of her bitter supporters not to waste a single minute on that, but to work together for what still can be. And that has been her approach to life. And so she just keeps moving forward. I think that's a very, very unusual and positive thing. She would be my candidate for one of the most daring women in the world.
Gail Sheehy, what role do you think, and this is something since you deal with personalities in your profiles, how should we be looking at personalities of politicians versus the policies that they actually implement?
Well, you know, the thing is that things move so quickly now that policies are pretty much not what's going to happen when a president or even a senator or a representative gets into office. Policies are what is today. What's yesterday and tomorrow? Character. That's what mattered with Richard Nixon. You know, his policies were very popular with many Democrats. What took him down? His character. He was a paranoid. He was a, you know, disturbed man. He had no capacity for trusting anyone or being close to anyone. That was character. What brought Lyndon Johnson down? His habit of lying for his entire life. He lied about Vietnam until he was finally exposed. And then he couldn't face living this lie any longer. What almost brought Bill Clinton down? He was a very popular president. We had peace and prosperity. But it was his character and the proclivities that came from his past that almost took him out of office.
You're listening to an interview with the late Gail Sheehy, who died on August 24th, 2020, of complications from pneumonia, possibly brought on by COVID-19. The interview was conducted at Book Passage Bookstore in Corte Madera, California, on September 24th, 2014, while she was on tour for her final book, Daring, My Passages. I'm Richard Wolinsky on the Bookwaves, Artswaves Hour. Gail Sheehy, it's also the case that you go back 20, 30 years and something like Monica Lewinsky wouldn't have even come up. They'd have been quiet about it. It wouldn't have been an issue. That kind of scandal wouldn't have necessarily happened.
That's because the only journalists were men.
Oh, really?
That's right. It all changed when women came into political journalism in the late 60s.
Why do you think that is?
Because we look at the whole person. And because there's a male code that said it was okay to be a Lothario, no matter what office you held, and to pretend that you were a moral person and that you were upholding family values. Meanwhile, in your personal life, many of these leaders who were shown on the cover of the New York Times magazine last week, were living a lie. And the biggest liar of them all was Gary Hart. And when he was caught, nobody could figure out why would he, you know, talk to a New York Times reporter and challenge the top political reporter to put a tail on me. If you don't believe these ridiculous rumors about my skirt chasing, follow me. You'll be bored. Well, the opposite was true. But it wasn't. The problem with Hart was not adultery. The problem with Hart was character. And I was the one who worked very hard to unfold all the antecedents of his character, starting with the Nazarene Church, a very, very repressive fundamentalist sect, which denied him any pleasures, any sentient pleasures at all through his childhood. No radio listening, no movies, no girls, no drinking, no sex, no partying. He went right through the Nazarene College. He came out, he volunteered for the George McGovern campaign, and he went over the wall. He abandoned his family and his wife and slept with every girl on the campaign and ultimately palled up with Warren Beatty and became a devotee of Turnberry Isle, the Miami resort where he was caught on the party boat with Diana Rice. He had to get caught because he couldn't be a worthy man as he had been trained to be in the church by denying himself any sentient pleasures, and also a sinner. So he was a double man, and he imploded. And had he been the president, he would have imploded during the presidency, and it would have been terrible.
Well, it sounds from reading your book, Gail Sheehy, daring my passages, it sounds as if the first time you met him, on some level you knew that. You knew something was weird.
I did. You're absolutely right. But the reason was, rather than going, you know, directly to the quarry and interviewing him before I know anything, I was moving around the outside and I was tipped off to talk to an Indian American woman called Marilyn Youngbird. And she told me these fantastic stories about how she and Gary Hart would go to the sweat lodge, would go to Indian ceremonies, would be brushed with eagle feathers, and how erotic it was and how close they were. And she gave me a note to pass on to Senator Hart, which I did when I was on the campaign plane. And he said, "You know Marilyn Youngbird?" All excited. And I said, "Yes." And she gave me this note. The note said, "Get away from everybody. Hug a tree." And he was thrilled with it. He said, "She's my spiritual advisor." I said, "Really?" And he said, "Yes. And she's always telling me that I should, you know, take another sweat lodge ceremony." And I said, "Well, her parents, who are medicine people, also have prophesied that you've been chosen by God to save the earth from destruction." He said, "Yes, I know. She tells me that all the time." And I said, "Do you believe it?" "Yes," he said. So when I laid this all out, I had thought this woman was just, you know, a groupie with having these fantasies about the handsome senator. But it all was true. And he got the reputation of having a flake factor. And Walter Mondale, who was considering taking him on as a vice presidential candidate, backed away very fast.
Do you think they're still looking at character like that? I mean, when I look at the Republican potential nominees for president, I'm appalled. And I keep thinking, you know, if somebody does a character study like that on Chris Christie, he'd be out of the picture. Or Rand Paul, they'd be out of the picture.
Well, I think you're right. I think you're right, because what is revealed becomes unavoidable. You see the pattern of behavior, particularly when people are under stress or they have to make a major decision, and you see that, well, this is what we would get. Is that what we would want in the White House? And I think we'd find it more and more difficult to choose presidents. And, you know, the problem is that I've interviewed so many of these characters that most of them are a little crazy. They are. They'd have to be crazy to want to run for president. It's a terrible job. It's really hard.
And, but it's power.
That is power. I know. But you have to be a little crazy to want power that badly, to sacrifice everything for it. And most of them sacrifice their marriages, not Obama, but most of the others in one way or another. And they sacrifice friends. They sacrifice privacy, of course. And if they make it through and still have a reputation intact, it's quite admirable and amazing and rare.
I can go in different directions, but I'm going to ask you a very Berkeley question, which is, a lot of people in Berkeley just simply think that when it comes to politics, the fix is in anyway, from Wall Street, from the military-industrial complex, that the fix is in. What do you think about that idea?
Well, certainly our politics are all based on money. I mean, up to a large degree, most of our politicians are bought by their contributors. And who are their major contributors? The Koch brothers, you know, some of the Democratic major hitters, and they get what they want. They get the tax breaks they want. They get the access they want. They, you know, are able to, I mean, look what happens with gun control. The public, by and large, is for restricting gun availability and bullet availability. But it gets bigger and bigger all the time. Why? Because the NRA has all the money.
Gail Sheehy, let me ask you about the Sheehy Daring Project. What is it?
Thank you. Well, this is one of the reasons I wrote the book, is I wanted to excite particularly younger women to be more daring. The 20s are the time to be daring. You can't really hurt anybody if you don't have a family yet, and you have the opportunity to fail. And this is the best thing that can happen to you when you're in your 20s, because if you fail once or twice, you find out you don't die from it. and maybe you'll take another chance and a bigger chance and become accustomed to it. And you have to do it certainly in the age of Silicon Valley. That's the way people make great breakthroughs. But in a period that we're in, which is one of great uncertainty and economic uncertainty, we're still recovering from the 2008 debacle. I think a lot of young people are kind of hanging on the edge, wanting to be safe, wanting to get a secure job, wanting to get married, maybe a little earlier this time, have a family, you know, really put down roots. But we found out that, particularly for women, postponing marriage, really fulfilling getting the best education you can, and then the post-education and trying different career paths until you find the one that really fits, and then having a marriage, and then having children. Now, I know that's the old-fashioned lineup of order, but it's still the one that the people who are most successful and have the best well-being and the most successful children is still the one that they perform.
And what is the project itself? What are you trying to get?
I'm trying to get stories of daring that young women and women of all ages can tell me. Just send me a capsule to SheehyDaringProject.com, and I'm going to be publishing lots and lots of these capsule stories of daring. It can be anything from, as one came in the other day, a girl who, when she was 8 years old, her farmer father, you know, picked up a huge worm when they were weeding and said, "If you bite this, I'll give you $5. And she bit it, and the green and grisly guts came out, and it was horrible, but she got $5 for it. And she became daring thereafter. Or as somebody who's in their 50s, and they just strike out on a whole new career, start something of their own, and it takes them in a whole new direction.
Do you think down the road we're going to be seeing a even greater proliferation of women politicians and women leaders? Do you think that's the direction we're headed in at this point?
Well, I wish we were headed in it a little more quickly, because we seem to be stuck at 20% in the Senate and the House. But I definitely think it's happening. We're running up against a lot of crossfire right now, and the whole women's movement seems to be stalled or on life support. But I certainly, if there is a woman president, things would change very radically and quite quickly, because Hillary Clinton, just as she's done all around the world, would appoint a lot of women and empower a lot of women and a lot of daughters to aspire more highly than they do now.
And so your next project is going to be this, going to be a book down the road?
Very likely. I think we all like to read about the stories that would inspire us.
Gail Sheehy, what do you think of gotcha journalism?
Well, I think that was the sort of gutter form of new journalism was, okay, let's just see what bad thing we can get on a famous person. What kind of gossip, what kind of, you know, or half-assed gossip we can get up there, and then put the person in the position of defending it when it's not even true. And I think that's, you know, part of our celebrity culture. And it's an ugly form. And it disparages the more serious form, which is to actually do a character report and take a lot of time to analyze what you find, and then to actually compare it with the person so that they have a chance to illuminate or prevaricate and help you get a larger picture.
What role do you think Rupert Murdoch played in all that?
Well, I think Rupert Murdoch has cannibalized the media, and he has no interest in editorial integrity or upholding any kind of taste standards. He's only about two things: making money, which he certainly made gajillions, and using his media outlets to give him access to power and to get more privileges to build his business and bypass rules and laws that inhibit other media outlets.
You've been listening to an interview with the late Gail Sheehy, who died on August 24th, 2020, of complications from pneumonia, possibly brought on by COVID-19. The interview was conducted at Book Passage Bookstore in Corte Madera, California, on September 24th, 2014, while she was on tour for her final book, Daring, My Passages. You're listening to the Bookwaves Artswaves Hour. I'm Richard Wolinsky, and coming up now, the Artswaves portion of the program.
My guest is Madhuri Shekar, who is a playwright. Her play In Love and Warcraft will be streaming live September 4th through 12th, and then on demand September 18th through 25th as an Interact at Home initiative production by ACT, American Conservatory Theater, featuring students from the MFA program. Madhuri Shekar is a playwright with several plays, including A Nice Indian Boy, Queen, House of Joy, which played last year at Cal Shakes, and Daba on Devon Avenue, which was about to open at the Victory Garden Theater in Chicago, but closed down because of the pandemic. In Love and Warcraft was at Custom Made Theater a few years back in San Francisco. I believe I saw it. This is a play that's been around for a few years, and we've seen these Zoom plays. We've seen various kinds of productions. What exactly is this? I understand that there was a test of it last week to see how it worked. What are people going to see when they buy tickets and they get the link?
Yeah, so actually this is a reprise of the MFA production that they did back in April and May by the MFA students and Peter. I got a chance to see it back when they did it in the spring, and it just blew me away. So this was before all the shutdowns started happening. This was just going to be a normal MFA production of this play, and this play has had many productions. So it was just going to be like a really great acting exercise for these students. But then when the shutdowns happened, Peter decided, what if I completely translate this play to the Zoom medium and not just do a reading, right? Not just do actors staring into the camera, doing the lines, you know, and we follow along that way. What if I actually make a production given all of the possibilities and limitations of Zoom? And he did such an incredible job. It was one of, honestly, the best theatrical experiences of my life because of the context of everything. You know, it was early in the shutdowns and we were all really feeling the loss of live theater and feeling the uncertainty of everything. And this was a moment where I got to hang out in the chat room with a bunch of my theater friends that I wouldn't be able to see otherwise. And we got to watch a play, and it really felt like a play. It was just wonderful. It was a live performance by all of these actors.
If person A is talking to person B, do they turn toward that little box and talk to them? How does that work?
Yes, they do sometimes. They do that sometimes. They don't do that with every scene. In some scenes, it actually feels weirdly seamless, like the actors are matching eye lines and they're talking to each other across boxes, and there's like set decoration in the background, which makes it feel like they're in the same space. So sometimes that happens. Other times what you're watching seems to be like two different camera angles, but again, through very clever set decoration, what it feels like they're in the same room. And then sometimes there's just like something else going on. There's like really, really innovative use of cell phone cameras, you know, and all sorts of things. It's kind of hard to explain. It feels like this wonderful, incredible hybrid of live performance, television, theater, and just something completely new.
So this live stream version is going to be playing for about 7 or 8 performances then?
I think so, yeah. I think there's going to be a few live ones, so everybody gets to join in the fun and like watch it live and be in the chat room, which is really, really fun. And then I think if you miss those, you get to see a recording of one of those productions.
That's the stream version. So these are actually like live plays. So there could be mistakes just like in a theater.
Exactly. And these are all actors who are in their apartments in different parts of the country and even out of the country. One of the actors back in spring, he was at home in Brazil, but they were all sharing time together. You know, this is like, you know, theater, you share space and you share time. We're not sharing space anymore, but they were sharing time together. It was really beautiful.
The backgrounds are created by a third party and inserted behind, or they do that as part of their work?
There are no digital backgrounds except for one scene, which if you're familiar with the play, I think you can guess what that scene will be. If you're not familiar with the play, I'm not going to spoil it. The actors are just in their apartments. However, through incredibly clever set decoration and incredibly clever framing, their apartments turn into different locations. There's this one incredible scene where two characters are in a bar and the camera angles are looking at them from the ground up. You have this feeling that you're watching them from like from the level of the bar. You're looking up at their faces and therefore you see the ceiling behind them and you see the ceiling and there are all of these fairy lights on the ceiling. So it feels like a hipster bar. And I was just so curious, how did you get out into a bar? What happened there? And it turns out that one actor, his apartment had that wooden beam. So they were like, that's really pretty. Let's just do a scene over there. And the other actor who was sharing the scene with him, she got under the table. She got under her wooden dining table and put fairy lights on the underside of her dining table and did the whole scene crouched down. And so because of that, it feels like they're both in the same bar together, but they're not. They do such incredible, innovative things. You know, it's really amazing.
Madhuri Shekar, let's talk a little about the play. Now, it's been around for a while. It's comedy, Cyrano de Bergerac, kind of, about a woman who prefers her life playing games. She also, as a side hobby, writes love letters for different people. Then she has a client that she kind of becomes attracted to. A lot of your plays, in particular House of Joy, are very political. This one is not. Or is it?
So when I wrote this play, and I wrote it in grad school, and I was 24 when I wrote this play, or 23. It was me when I was very young. And I sent it out, and I thought, geez, you know, I was also writing my other play, A Nice Indian Boy, at the time, which is about gay marriage in an Indian family. So yeah, I do write about stuff that's kind of big. But this play felt incredibly private, incredibly small to me, incredibly personal to me. And I was like, what am I doing? Who's going to care? But this wound up being the play that weirdly resonated the most with a lot of people and has kind of gave me my career. It resonates so deeply with women, with young women. And I think because the play is all about, honestly, like the politics of sex and the politics of how do we perform sexuality? Who gets to enjoy sex? Who decides how we're supposed to enjoy sex? Who decides whether we're supposed to enjoy sex at all? What counts as desire? What doesn't count as desire? Like, it's all of these things that are very, very personal that I was feeling definitely at the time, still do. It's very gratifying when I hear from young people who see the play. You know, this is a very tricky time in your life when you're in college and you're trying to figure out what you're about. And if you're really confused about sex, it can be hard to find stories that directly talk about that feeling. And if you're confused about love and how it like gets itself enmeshed and entangled with sex and sexuality, it feels like a private emotion, but actually a lot of us are feeling it all the time.
What are the origins of the play? I mean, what prompted you to start writing it? Were you involved in some kind of Warcraft online play?
No, I've never played World of Warcraft. I researched it extensively for writing the script, but the ideas kind of came from multiple places and just all kind of came together. I was in grad school at USC in LA, and my professor, Belina Hasu Houston, in our first semester just casually mentioned one day that she made money in college by writing love letters for men, for boys who had screwed things up with their girlfriends. And I was like, that's an incredible premise for a romantic comedy. Let's start from there. And so the first draft of the play didn't have Warcraft at all. But the other thing that I really wanted to write about was the very deep friendships and relationships that I had been making online since I was 13. And I had spent like a good chunk of my teenage years in different fandom communities and writing fan fiction and making really good friends. And I hadn't yet seen a story or a play or a TV show or a movie that was about how real those relationships can be and how satisfying those relationships can be. And sometimes how it's an easy place to hide if you actually don't want to interact with people in real life. So those two things kind of came together, and that's how the play was born.
Had you been involved in theater when you were growing up?
I grew up in different countries. I was born in the Bay Area in San Jose, and then we moved to Singapore when I was 6, and then we moved to India when I was 9, and then I did middle school, high school, college in India.
Where in India?
In Chennai. When I was very small in the Bay Area, my dad did a lot of theater with his friends, and that was really, really fun to watch. And I really loved the vibe of those rehearsals that they would have at our house. But then I didn't actually get to do theater at all until I started college in India. And then once I started college, I went to an all-girls college in Chennai, and I just threw myself into the Dramatics Club, because I think I'd been having this hankering my whole life to do theater, but this was the first time I would really get the opportunity to do so. I loved theater a lot. I just fell in love with it in college.
At that point, were you acting? What were you doing in college?
I was acting, I was writing, I was directing, I was producing. You jump in and you do everything.
Well, what turned you on most to playwriting as opposed to acting and directing?
I'd always been writing. So I'd always been writing poetry or short stories and then fan fiction, like I mentioned before. I really, really loved writing. I loved acting and directing, but writing was where I realized, but I can create something completely new. You know, like when we were trying to figure out what plays to put on in college, there aren't that many plays out there for an ensemble cast of Indian women, right? And stuff that actually meant something to us and was pertinent to us. So I was like, we need more plays about us in the English language. I can do that. So that's kind of where that impulse came from. And it's just become something that I enjoy the most.
Madhuri Shekar, when you wrote this first play in Love and Warcraft, you sent it out and people said, we like it. Or how did that work? How did you get your start as a professional playwright then?
This was my big break play, I like to call it. We did a workshop of it in grad school as part of the program. That was really, really fun, really gratifying. Learned a lot. And then my final year of grad school, I submitted it to the Candida Graduate Playwriting Contest that's run by the Alliance Theater in Atlanta. And it's an incredible, wonderful program open to basically MFA graduating students in playwriting. And the winning play every year gets a full professional production at the Alliance Theater in Atlanta. So this play won, which was amazing. And because of that, I got a production January of 2014, less than a year after I graduated from USC. And it was just a truly wonderful production, an incredible experience. It got published because of that, and I got my agent because of that. It just opened all of these doors. I just got to meet so many other theater people, and the Alliance Theater in particular became a wonderful supporter of my work, and they wound up commissioning two more plays from me, both of which I'm really proud of, and they produced my plays. So this play was my calling card, essentially.
Let's talk for a second about House of Joy, which deals with life in a kind of fantasy real India.
Yeah.
What is the origin of that particular play?
I went to college in India and I studied Indian history. That was my degree. I loved the Mughal history in India. It was my favorite thing to study. And I had been wanting to write a play set in that time period or inspired by that time period for a long time. In 2016, winter of 2016, I was at Juilliard in the Juilliard Playwriting Fellowship. The great thing about that program is that you're meant to write three new plays a year, which can be intense. You know, I had just finished a new play for that program and I was like, okay, now I need to come up with an idea for another one. I stumbled across this article about harems in the Mughal Empire. And even though I had studied it in college, this article just was kind of blew my mind and I didn't know half the things about harems and about these communities of women and how they lived. That was pretty soon after the election. I remember I was just grasping for something to write about that would help me function.
Right.
I think as a lot of people were, I was in a real whirlwind of emotion and feeling kind of in despair about the place of theater and all of this. And House of Joy and the story that started coalescing in my head gave me the opportunity to like run far away from America of 2016 and go to fantasy India of the 17th century. That was fun and good for me, but also as the story kept developing, it was clear that I was just writing about what was going on right now. And, you know, I was very angry every day. And this was a good way to just get out my anger, pound the keyboard and write the story. So that's where it came from.
You're listening to an interview with Madhuri Shekar, who is the playwright of In Love and Warcraft, which will be live streamed by ACT September 4th through 12th and on demand September 18th to 25th. And for more information, you can go to act-sf.org. I'm Richard Wolinsky on the Bookwaves Artswaves Hour. For the past 3.5 years, we've been living in some kind of strange alternate reality, but it seems to have taken a huge turn in the past 8 months. For you as a playwright, knowing theater is kind of changing into a different reality for the moment. But as a playwright, when you start writing now, what happens to you? I mean, where do you go?
I haven't written anything in several months. Part of that is because I'm also a new mom. So I have a seven-month-old, and I feel like he's growing up. We're counting down the time of the pandemic with him because he was born near the beginning of it. When I write a play, I have to visualize from the beginning. I have to visualize the space and the audience. I have to like see the stage in front of me. Many times I will think about, what is the dream theater that I am writing this play for? What is the space that I adore and I want to see this happen in? And I think about that, and I think about the audience, and I think about them sitting together. I can't think about that right now. You know, it feels too hard to imagine that at the moment. So I have not written anything for the stage, not since my play in Chicago got shut down. So I don't really know where I can go at the moment.
You did do a radio play called Evil Eye, which I understand has become a film.
So that was an audio play. The only thing I am kind of working on, ideating in my head, is another audio play right now, because I can imagine how it will work at this moment. Evil Eye, I started writing in 2017, and we produced it as an audio play for Audible, which commissioned the play, and it went up on the Audible platform last year in May. And around the same time, the film adaptation began to happen as well.
One of the things that has occurred, the BLM movement, racism in the theater, the fact that most of the people running New York theaters are white, The idea of diversity in the theater, what is your take on how theater itself is changing to accommodate this new reality, this new understanding of the role of racism in America?
I don't know if it's changing. I don't know. I think it is incredibly hard to change power structures. And I don't know if it's changing. So I actually kind of went on a rant on Facebook a couple of days ago, because it's been 5 months, 6 months into all of the shutdowns, and live theater is not viable, not even until there's a vaccine, but until there is uniform application of the vaccine. It's gone for a while. And I have been personally quite disillusioned with the ways in which institutional theaters have not reached out to the hundreds of thousands of freelance artists that work for them, who are out of a job, who are out of benefits, who are facing real serious financial crises and health crises right now. You know, I genuinely feel that economic part of it is also tied into, you know, the racial part of it. It's all tied into power and who has power and who's sharing power and who are we fighting for? Who do we prioritize at any moment? I don't know if I'm really qualified to talk about the whiteness of theater. I've been a woman of color working in this system quite successfully for several years, and I honestly have conflicting feelings about that. I don't know. I don't want to be complicit in a system that's harming people just because it happens to be beneficial for me in a certain way. But I've also felt many times that my career also is not where I would want it to be, simply because of many, many assumptions that kind of happen along the way of what constitutes valuable art, stuff like that.
Do you see your plays perhaps becoming more political then because of these feelings?
Honestly, I feel like if you write something that has a very specific point of view and is deeply truthful to your experience, it will inevitably be political. That's just what politics is. It's your very specific point of view based on your personal experience, how you want to see the world and how you want to live as a human being. That's political.
What do you see as the difference between, say, live theater, September 4th through 12th, and on-demand theater, September 18th through 25th, film, television? What is the value of the live performance as opposed to these other edited performances?
Oh my gosh. Oh, you can never replace live theater. Never. It is our oldest, most primal form of storytelling. It's gone away in the way we're used to in kind of conventional American theater for a short time, but it will never die out. It's the most wonderful way to just tell stories, and I fully and truly believe that. I'm excited about In Love and Warcraft, not as a piece of live theater, but as a completely new, beautiful invention of live performance that reminds you a lot of the camaraderie of seeing live theater, because you're seeing people do something in real time with you, and you're terrified for them that something might go wrong. But you're also in a chat room with a whole bunch of other people, and you're all responding together. You know, it's a different kind of feeling. You're not feeling like the unconscious, silent, audible responses that you might share with people that you're rubbing shoulders with inside a, you know, a cramped auditorium. But there's so much of the Zoom performance that is reminiscent of that. But at the same time, it takes a lot of techniques from film and TV and internet content, and like the very beautiful and wonderful ways in which people create content specifically for the internet. And it melds it all together. I'm just inspired by what Peter and the actors have done. I just think it's like an incredible, incredible new art form that they're developing. And I would love to see more plays being done this way while we're in this situation right now. But gosh, nothing can beat live theater.
Madhuri Shekar, I want to ask you about some stuff I found on IMDb. You were a writer for a comedy web series called Titus and Dronicus.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yes, I'm very proud of that.
What is it?
Me and two other writers, Megan Kelly and Seamus Sullivan, Seamus, who is now my husband, we were very close. Megan and I went to the same MFA program at USC, and we wanted to make a TV show together. So we decided, let's try and do this for the internet. Let's try and make a short web series. So we wrote it and produced it together. Our director was Liz Rizzo. We had a really wonderful time making it. It's a Shakespearean web series comedy. So it's basically about two detectives called Titus and Dronicus, and the conceit was that in each season they would investigate a crime that's inspired by a Shakespeare play. So season one, which is as far as we got, was Hamlet. Episode one was basically about these two detectives being visited by this dame, Ophelia, and, you know, we're drawing on all the noir stereotypes, and Ophelia's like, my boyfriend's going crazy, can you figure out what's going on with him, please? And so Titus and Dronicus decide, okay, we're going to solve the mystery of why Hamlet's acting weird. And then in the course of getting involved in Hamlet's story, they then make everything worse. So that's kind of the premise of the show.
Is it available for anybody to watch now?
Oh, yeah, yeah. You can go to titusandadronicus.com. It's all up there. You can go to YouTube and just type in Titus and Dronicus, and you can watch it.
And then there was something called Paperless Pulp, a TV series.
That was another audio play series. So that is available on Spotify and Stitcher and all of the podcast platforms.
You are a staff writer for an upcoming HBO series. Is that correct?
My first TV job was this incredible, wonderful thing. I got to write for Joss Whedon's new TV show, The Nevers, which is slated to come out on HBO, probably 2021.
Has it been filmed yet?
It's in production in London. Hopefully things continue and they're able to finish it.
I understand they're restarting some productions now.
Yeah, yeah. I think that's what's happening.
And as a staff writer, did you fly to meetings and sit in a room with people, or how did that work?
So I was and am living in Jersey City. I got the job, which was amazing. And then I moved to LA for 6 months to be in the writer's room. It was really great.
I'm always fascinated by what the writer's room is like. Who was Joss Whedon the showrunner?
Yes, yes. He is the showrunner, creator, head writer, all of that.
And how was it working with him?
It was really great. I mean, it's so surreal even talking about it. You know, I grew up on his TV shows.
Buffy.
Yeah, Buffy and Angel and Firefly, like that. That was what I grew up on. It was crazy enough to meet with him, and then to actually get hired was amazing. And his second in command in the room was Jane Espenson, who's another one of my favorite TV writers. I never had a chance to meet her, but I'd always been following her work. And it was a wonderful, really diverse writer's room. Everybody was just lovely and so charming and so funny. And the show was right up my alley. You know, it's period. It's set in Victorian times. It's about really strong women who kick ass, which is his trademark. And House of Joy is very similar to that. So, you know, the timing was very fortuitous. And it was just really cool to be in the room.
Well, when you're in the room like that, do you have like writers just sitting around at a table shouting out ideas? I mean, how does a episode come together?
I've only been on this one TV show so far, so I can't speak for all TV shows, but in
right,
general,
but yours.
Yeah. So in general, it's, you know, it's Joss's show. It's his vision. It's his story, and he knows what he wants. And so we are there to help him get that vision in the form of scripts for episodes. So like he knows, you know, how the story begins, how the story ends. He knows the characters. And then there are gaps in the middle. And so we as writers really are brainstorming and helping figure out how the season kind of builds and develops. And then we all get scripts to write. We break the scripts in the room. We outline the scripts together, basically offering up ideas, and the best idea wins. And, you know, when it's time to write the script, we take the outline that we've created together in the room, and the writer goes off and writes a very detailed outline, and then they write a first draft, and they write a second draft, and, you know, as many rewrites as time permits or as is needed. And, you know, and it's all in service of the showrunner's vision. So you really need to have that skill of being able to write in the showrunner's voice, especially a showrunner whose voice is as distinctive as Joss Whedon's. So all of my years of writing fan fiction actually really helped me out.
When you wrote fan fiction, that was science fiction fan fiction?
No, I wrote it for Harry Potter.
You wrote Harry Potter fan fiction?
Oh, yes. And I read so much of it. That's how I learned how to write. I learned how to write by writing fan fiction.
This was when you were in India?
Yes, yeah.
You got into Harry Potter when you were in school in India and began writing fan fiction about Harry Potter and Hermione?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, yep.
Was it published online?
Yeah. No, it was published online. I don't think like a lot of it remains, but, you know, it was published online. I made a lot of really great friends who I'm still great friends with. They are real life friends now. Like a few of them came to my wedding.
You just found adventures to put them in?
Yeah. There was this huge gap between books 4 and 5. And that was when I was online. And so we were all trying to imagine what would happen in the later books, but we were also all trying to imagine what happened in the spaces between the books or what happened before the books even began. Like when you create a really rich world like Harry Potter, then it's a wonderful playground for aspiring writers to play in.
Madhuri Shekar, when life resumes, however it resumes, I assume that you'll probably maybe show up in a different writer's room or begin writing screenplays?
That's kind of what I'm doing now. I'm happy to get employment where I can get it. And I think there's a lot of really wonderful opportunities in the TV and films. It's a cool time to be a writer with a very specific point of view because the media landscape is so vast right now that there's space for you. There's so much content out there, basically, that if you have something, if you have a very interesting and personal story to tell, there is space for that.
You've been listening to an interview with Madhuri Shekar, whose play Love and Warcraft is being put on by ACT, live streamed September 4th through 12th, and on demand September 18th through 25th. That's part of the Interact at Home initiative from ACT. For information and tickets, you can go to act-sf.org. An extended version of this interview can be found in the Bay Area Theater podcast in the Area 941 section of kpfa.org. Until next week, I'm Richard Wolinsky on the Bookwaves Artswaves Hour.
Registered to vote? Are you sure? You can find out in 30 seconds at vote.org. They'll check your registration status or register you. At vote.org, you can request an absentee ballot and get election reminders like this one. Make sure you vote early so that your vote gets counted. Pass on vote.org to your family and friends across the country. Make sure you exercise your right. A 2020 election reminder from KPFA.
I'm Sonali Kohatkar, host of Rising Up with Sonali, which airs Monday through Friday at 3 p.m. on KPFA. Our program begins each broadcast with our daily news headlines, bringing you the latest breaking news, followed by in-depth conversations with analysts and newsmakers. On Rising Up with Sonali, you get progressive analysis of the news rooted in gender, racial, economic, and social justice. Join me every weekday at 3 p.m. on 94.1 KPFA.
After months of precautions, lockdowns, and social distancing, the coronavirus cases and hospitalizations continue to spike in the Bay Area. It's really KPFA's communal duty to remind everybody to remain cautious, stay vigilant about wearing masks, hand washing, and social distancing. We would all like to return to our regular activities, but first we have to remain alive. Be safe, be smart, be well. And thanks for listening to KPFA.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at kpfa.org.